I have the honor to introduce the first presenter of the Turkish representatives, Dr. Fehmi Arikan, General Director of Nature Conservation and National Parks. He is going to talk about the game and wildlife in Turkey.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I'd like to thank you all for being here, and I would like to especially thank to our Hungarian colleagues, Hungarian friends, for organizing this wonderful event. And we all have a pleasure to be part of it, and we are very grateful for this invitation. So, my name is Fehmi Arikan, as you can see from the screen. I'm working for the Department of Game Management, working under the General Directorate of Nature Conservation and Natural Parks. Today, I hope without boring you, I'd like to give you a brief information about game and wildlife management in Turkey. How do we manage wildlife? How do we protect wildlife and habitats? And how do we utilize, let me say, from these natural resources. So my presentation will have mainly two parts. The first one will be focusing on the wildlife management, and the second part will be longer and will be on game management in Turkey. So, before doing that, I'd like to give you a brief information about Turkey, for those who don't know. The capital of Turkey is Ankara. It is the city which I live in. And the total area of Turkey is nearly 700,000 square meters, and it makes us the 36th largest country of the world. And when you look at the proportion of land and water, you will see that nearly 1.78% of the land is covered with water. And according to the latest surveys, the population of Turkey is more than 80 million people, and it makes us the 17th crowdest country in the world. When you look at the density, it is 105 square kilometer, and it is the 104th mostly dense country in the world. We use Turkish lira as a currency. We are one of a G20 country, which makes us one of the largest economies, the largest 20 economies of the world. And from the map, you can see that our location can be considered as a bridge between Europe and Asia. As far as I know, there are a few countries which have lands in two different continents. We have lands on the Asian continent called Anatolia, Anadolu, and we have lands in the European continent called Thrace, Trakya. And as long as the biological diversity of Turkey is concerned, we can say that Turkey has a very rich biodiversity due to its geological and morphological structure and its geographical location in the world. And this is the same for game and wildlife. And it wouldn't be wrong to say that more than 80% of the plant and animal species of the European continent are represented in Turkey, and we are really proud of that. And you can see an osprey on the left side. As I told you, we have climate diversity, geological diversity. We are on the transition point between Europe, Asia, and Africa. So this provides us a unique richness of biodiversity, and it can be considered as a continent in terms of biological diversity. When you look at the table, you can see that we have 175 mammals, 500 birds, more than 12,000 plants, which more than 3,000 of them are endemic to Turkey. We have nearly 40 amphibians, more than 400 fish, 146 reptiles, and in total, we have we have 13,404 different plant and animal species existing in Turkey. This diversity also applies to the ecosystems. I know it is the second time, but I'd like to underline that we are on the intersection point of three different geographical regions, and therefore we have forest, mountain, meadow, steppe, wetland, coastal, and marine ecosystems, and different forms and combinations of these ecosystems. You know, if you have something, then you should protect it, and we are trying to protect our natural resources and protected areas, not only according to national laws, but also according to international laws and conventions. So we fulfill our obligations arising from international legislation as well as national legislation, and we are a party to very important international conventions such as CITES, Ramsar, CBD, IUCN, and Bern Convention. When you look at this graphic, you will see the numbers of the protected areas in Turkey. So we have 45 national parks, 257 natural parks, 31 nature protection areas, 113 natural monuments, 85 wildlife conservation areas. I will provide you a detailed information about wildlife conservation areas. We have 14 Ramsar areas. We have 59 nationally imported wetlands, and we have 18 locally imported wetlands. In total, it makes 622 protected areas covering more than 3 million hectares. So, finally, we are at the game and wildlife management. You can easily understand how important it is for us to protect wildlife, since two out of six departments are dedicated to wildlife and game management in my general directorate. So there are specific departments for the wildlife management and game management separately. So we carry out control hunting activities as well as protection and development of wildlife in our country. And you can see an Anatolian mufflon, and if you visit our stand, you will also see a full taxidermy of it. Here on the left side, there is an Anatolian mufflon. And this table is to provide you to make you have an idea about the proportion of game animals comparing to the wild animals. So if you look at the first column, we have 175 mammals, as I told you, and 146 of them are protected by the law. And we have a central hunting commission. I will explain it later. So the central hunting commission decides every year which of them must be protected and which of them can be subject to hunting. So for instance, this year, only five small members, small mammals are subject to hunt. When you look at the birds, we have 500 birds and only 30 of them are subject to hunt. For reptiles, hunting is, as you know, it's not possible. They are all strictly protected. We follow two main routes in order to protect our natural resources. The first one is declare protected areas, and the second one is to prepare and to get them active species-specific action plans. In this context, action plans have been prepared for nearly 100 sensitive species since 2013, and you can see endangered samples, let me say, from plants and animals living in Turkey. So, as I told you, we have wildlife conservation areas. These are especially dedicated to protect and conserve wildlife resources, nothing else. So we have 81 wildlife conservation areas. They cover more than 1 million hectares. And if you look at the chart, you will see that 22 of them are for birds, for wild birds. For instance, Otis tarda is one of them. And 63 of them are dedicated for mammals, for instance, striped hyena. By the way, we have also a full taxidermy of striped hyena in our stand. Sorry. So, what do we do? I'm sorry, these videos should be started automatically, but anyway, in order to monitor these wild animals, we use photo traps, we ring animals, and we use We use GPS colors. Why do we do that? We use them in order to document the presence of target species in the study area, to monitor the population change of existing species in the study area over the years. And you can see a bearded vulture, and there are two wolves playing, and there is this brown bear playing with a crow, and this curious red deer. Sometimes you get very exciting videos from wild animals. Okay. As I told you, we use photo traps across country. Right now on the field there are more than 3,000 photo traps. And these are the examples of species that we photographed in Turkey for the very first time. As you may realize, we especially have chosen the carnivores for this slide. We have striped hyena, lynx, brown bear, caracal. You can see caracal on our stand, and wolf. By the way, all large carnivores are strictly protected in Turkey. You cannot hunt any of them. So, let me give you two exciting, peculiar examples from wildlife studies. For instance, in a case, an Egyptian vulture, which was found exhausted in Ankara, and treated. We found it, we treated it, and we put an transmitter on it, and we realized that he went all the way to Chad from Turkey to spend the winter. And another case is from steppe eagles, which was mounted with a transmitter in July 2017. And we realized that he wintered in Chad and Cameroon for two consecutive years. I'd like to give you an example from Hungarian friends, with Hungarian friends, colleagues. Right now, there is a protocol between us and Hungarian friends, especially on monitoring imperial eagles and steppe eagles. So, in 2017 and between 2019, a great number of imperial eagles and steppe eagles were caught and mounted with transmitters. But unfortunately, in 2020, the studies were suspended, as we all know, because of COVID-19. We use collars for large mammals, as I told you so. Why do we do that, if you ask? We receive coordinates, as you know, from those GPS-colored animals, and we try to find out the seasonal mobility of the species, the site selection of the species, the regions where they meet their water and nutrition needs, and the projection strategy is all based on those information gathered from GPS-colored animals. We also carry out studies for injured, hurt wild animals. So we have 9 existing rehabilitation centers. They are in service right now, and 3 of them are under construction. We have 81 provinces and 81 provincial directorates. So in case of a citizen finds and hurts an injured animal, then they call our provincial directorates and we go immediately there and take care of the animal. And if it is suitable for releasing, then we release it. Let me give you an example. In the last 10 years, more than 30,000 animals were treated and released. So we also have breeding centers for wild animals. And when you look at the table, 12 of them are designated for dedicated to large mammals. I will show you which one of them are. And we have breeding centers for game birds, 8 of them. I will give you information very soon. We have 3 for trouts, and we have 1 breeding center for bull ibis. There is a taxidermy in our Turkish stand. We have been carrying out a conservation program for bald ibis for several years, and nearly 300 or 400 individuals are existing in the breeding center right now. So, which species that we breed and introduce? Red deer, fallow deer, gazelle, Anatolian mouflon. But let me warn you that these are not released for hunting purposes. These are released in order to increase the population level of animals in the wild. So between 2003 and 2020, more than 3,000 large mammals have been introduced. And as you can see from the footage, before doing that, we put colors and we monitor how successful we are at the reintroduction program. We also carry out midwinter waterfall counts in order to the change in the numbers of species and the population size over the years. So finally, we are at the hunting issue. I want you to have a general idea about the numbers of hunters in Turkey. We have nearly 3,000 hunters in Turkey, but these are not all actively hunting right now, because last hunting season, only 153 of them has received their annual hunting permission, which means that last year only 153,000 of them were actively hunting. We also provide, in order to become a hunter, you must finish a training and education program. And we have completed programs for nearly 500,000 hunters. And just in the first 8 months of 2021, nearly 6,500 people were trained. And you can see some photographs from the trainings. So this is a very short slide. What should you do to become a hunter in Turkey? First, you must have a hunting certificate. This is received. It is valid for lifetime. I mean, you receive it once, and it is valid for lifetime. It is nearly costs 36 euros. Then you should obtain your hunting permit annually. It is an annual card. And this is taken once for the hunting period, and it costs nearly 20 euros. I just want you to have a general idea how much it costs in Turkey to become a hunter. And finally, you must visit our webpage. I will give you the details very soon. It is called ABIS. It is a Turkish abbreviation. You must visit ABIS, and you must get your quota from ABIS for your day of hunting and for the hunting ground that you'd like to visit. So we try to regulate hunting with plans and quotas. So these are the steps that we follow. First, surveys and inventory of game animals and their habitats are made every year. Secondly, in line with the inventory data, hunting grounds are established and hunting plans are made. Finally, and thirdly, last but not least, hunting resources are harvested. Quota is given according to plans which were made. So, this is to give you a general idea of hunting grounds in Turkey. We have more than 2,000 hunting grounds, but I'd like to underline that most of them, maybe 99% of them, are governed and regulated by the ministry. These are all regulated and managed by the ministry. So, I mentioned that ABIS is a web-paged information system which enables hunters to get their quotas without leaving their homes. So, they should visit the webpage, they should select the date, the day they'd like to hunt, they should select the hunting ground they'd like to hunt, and they should select the animal that they like to hunt. These are all can be done through ABIS, and it is also give us the opportunity to electronically control whether the hunters and their hunting resources are harvested according to plans made by us. And as you know, it is sometimes difficult for elderly people to reach internet or to do something on the internet, especially for elderly people. And there are some rural interconnections sometimes. So we also have a call center. It is 7/24 open call center. And all hunters are very welcome to call this center and take their quotas on the phone. Thirdly, we also have a mobile application. AVA is developed in order to allow hunters to do whatever they do on ABIS. So if he wants to check if he is within the ground, within the hunting ground or not, or where he is located, or if he wants to get a quota at that time, then he can easily visit our application, our mobile application, and do whatever he does with ABIS. So, Central Hunting Commission is one of the key elements in managing game in Turkey. This commission is gathered once a year and chaired by the minister or deputy minister, and they make very important decisions such as determination of game animals to be protected, determination of hunting times, seasons and days, detection of prohibited hunting tools and equipment, determination of bag limits, identification of prohibited hunting areas, and they determine the principles and methods of hunting for combat purposes. We always try to make this commission with a participatory approach. So we invite nine members from state institutions, two from universities, four from NGOs, nine from hunter organizations, one from private hunting ground representatives, and in total, we have a commission for 25 members. So when you say hunting season in Turkey, it usually starts on August. This season it started on the 21st of August 2021, and it will end the 6th of March 2022. On Tuesdays, only for wild boars, on Tuesdays you can hunt, but for the rest You can go hunt Wednesdays, Saturdays, Sundays, and public holidays. Of course, you can only hunt within the limits set by central hunting commission's decisions. So, unfortunately, poaching, combat with illegal hunting is still a serious problem for us. But of course, in order to prevent poaching and to ensure the continuity of wildlife, we carry out 24-hour-based inspection and control activities with our ranger teams all over the country. We also follow the social media because, sometimes poachers would like to share their pictures, their memories on the social networks, and we definitely follow them, we find them, and we impose administrative fines for them. Let me give you a brief information about the organizational structure of my general directorate. There are 289 chiefdoms affiliated to 15 regional directorates, and they are actively working in all 81 provinces, in all 81 provincial directorates of my ministry. There are nearly 1,500 personnel which are assigned to combat with poaching. In addition to our personnel, gendarmerie, police, village headmans, and the honorary hunting inspectors are also involved in combat with poaching. So if you ask what are the most commonly faced regulatory items, let me say, what are the most broken ones, it is hunting outside of hunting time, not complying with hunting limit, hunting with boats and similar motor vehicles, hunting with vehicles while in motion and or using light, hunting with prohibited tools and equipment, and poison hunting. And you can see very strange methods. You cannot imagine how creative they are if it comes to poaching. So, in order to discourage their illegal activities, of course, we impose administrative fines. And in addition to administrative fines, we also impose compensation fines. So, annually, nearly 16,000 fines are imposed on an average of 80,000 people each year. And the average administrative fine is 1.2 million euros a year. And as I told you, if you a poacher, then you must compensate the animal you hunted illegally. And 1.1 million euros have been fined for compensation. So, I'm sorry, I think it must also start automatically. But anyway, we always try to use the latest, the modern technologies. The latest technologies in combat with poaching. I'm sorry, it doesn't work, but this is a photo trap footage, and you will see two guys taking a wild goat. Okay, so these are the poachers, and you can see the wild goat. These are all found by photo traps, and they had to pay fines and compensation fees. These are again poachers which we have busted with photo traps. So photo traps, they are not useful not only for wildlife monitoring but also for poaching monitoring. Okay. So as I told you, we try to use modern technologies in combat with poaching. So we have drones actually to fight with poachers. It is a very nice video. I hope it will start soon. You can see three guys hiding behind the rock. And yeah, great. So you can see three guys. You can see three guys. They think that the rangers are on the in front of them, but they don't know that they are being watched by drones from the air. Anyway. Another important issue is breeding and reintroduction of game animals and natural throats into the wild. Unfortunately, because of unconscious and excessive hunting, degradation of habitats, and uncontrolled and excessive use of pesticides, the level of populations for chukar and pheasants are decreasing in especially some regions. Therefore, we have breeding centers for them. In this table, you can see that we have two breeding stations for pheasants, and also you can see the capacity of them at the last column. And we have six breeding centers for chukars, Alectoris chukar. And one of them is also working on gray partridges. And you can see the annual capacity of them. But let me tell you something. We don't allow to hunt those animals. These animals are released into the areas which you cannot hunt for 3 years, three consecutive years. So in Turkey, we don't have breed, release, and hunt system. These are all released into the protected areas. And you can see a photograph of a breeding center in Gaziantep, province of Turkey, which is working on chukar breeding. So when you look at the numbers, last year more than 100,000 game birds were released. And in total, for the last 20 years, more than 1 million game birds have been bred and released to the nature. You can see the graphic from here. Okay, the second one is about throats, the natural throats. In order to optimize natural throat populations in forest waters, to rehabilitate of degraded throat habitats, to conserve of gene resources, and to promote our natural species, we are carrying out a program for natural throats living in forest waters. So lately, we are working on 20 different provinces in 50 different water sources. So how do we do that? First, we catch the breeding individuals from one water resource. We take the breeding individuals to the pools of the breeding center. Then we get fries, we get eggs and fries. Then we breed them, and once they are big enough, we release them to the same natural resource which the parents are taken. So we have three different breeding centers. One of them is in Trabzon, one of them is in Bersin, and one of them is in Bolu. When you look at the numbers, you will see that nearly 30 million throats were released within the last 20 years. Only last year, in 2021, 4,005,000 fish, juvenile fish, were released into the nature. In order to monitor if we are successful or not, we use a phosphorus liquid. Just behind the eye, you can see a thin red line. So we, before releasing some fish, we put this chemical, let me say, to his body. Then afterwards we release it, and then we catch it once more. And we monitor whether they adapt to environment or not. Their growth performances and the condition factors are examined on the site. So the results showed us that we are successful. It has been scientifically proven that the fish released by marking adapt to nature, and we could manage to increase the population. Okay, it is maybe one of the main reasons why we are all here, hunting tourism. Hunting tourism is also very important for us. And large mammals such as wild goat, Anatolian wild sheep, red deer, gazelle, roe deer, chamois, and wild boar are hunted within the scope of hunting tourism in the light of hunting plans with the permission of Ministry of Agriculture and Forestry. We believe that Turkey offers the best trophies of these species to foreign hunters. If a foreign visitor would like to come to visit Turkey in scope of hunting tourism, he can do it by a travel agency. He can go to a travel agency which has an A group license, and then he can come to our country. When you look at the statistics, we have visitors coming from 6 continents and 68 countries, and most of them are coming from France, Germany, USA, Spain, Austria, UK, Italy, and Denmark. Every year, an average of 2,000 foreign tourists visit our country for hunting purposes. Why do we do that? Why do we organize hunting tourism? In order to provide sustainable game and wildlife management, and especially support rural development, because the money received from hunting tourism, up to 50% of the total income, is transferred to the rural people, local people, to make them protect their natural resources. And of course, for preventive veterinary issues, keeping wildlife at optimal density levels, and for professional hunting management. So these are the game animals that we offer for foreign hunters. It is Anatolian wild sheep, wild goat, chamois, wild boar, red deer, gazelle, roe deer, chukar partridge, gray partridge, and pheasant. So what should a foreign hunter do to hunt in Turkey? As I told you, he must apply to a travel agency, and he can only hunt with a temporary hunting certificate for foreign tourist hunters, and he must be accompanied by my ministry's personnel. And foreign hunters can hunt with their rifles or shotguns, bullets, bows and arrows that they brought, in line with the law numbered 4915 on ground hunting. If you ask the forms of hunting in terms of hunting tourism, hunting organizations are held in the form of stalking and walking hunts. Wild boar can be hunted with stalking and dry hunt. The hunting period is 10 consecutive days. And if you need any further information about hunting tourism in Turkey, please visit our stand, and we will provide you leaflets and brochures involving detailed information about that. And you can see, this is one of the last slides, you can see the timetable of game species, the opening dates and closing dates. And finally, I wanted to give you some samples from gazelle. For instance, we have a trophy which has a horn length of 46 centimeters. We have a roe deer, antler weight is 720 grams. We have a white goat, you can see it on our stand, whose horn length is 155 centimeters. We have chamois, which has a horn length 26 to 27 centimeters. And red deer, which has an antler weight of 16.5 kilograms. I would like to thank you for your attention. I hope I didn't bore you with all those details and numbers. Thank you.